I'm going to show you how to make an underwater version of those contour diagrams. Bathymetry slices. Cute little sliced and stacked layers of the seafloor rendered in ArcGIS Pro using free GEBCO data. You will need the internet to download the data, ArcGIS Pro, with the 3D Analyst or Spatial Analyst extension, because we're going to use those to make contours. This is GEBCO's website where you can download patches of bathymetry from anywhere. It's a beautiful and generous resource. To draw a region, you hold the control key down and drag. I'll choose this interesting swath from the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. I'd like my download to be a GeoTIFF, which is one of my favorite formats, and I'll add it to my cart, or basket, I mean. So let's take a look at my basket. And GEBCO is super cool about this. They're like, you know what? This data is a little bit big and we're gonna have to email you a link. No problem, here's my email. And it only took about 5 minutes before it landed in my inbox, which is pretty great. I'll add this GeoTIFF to my ArcGIS Pro project, and there we go. The seafloor laid bare. We really are living in amazing times. By the way, welcome to the time of year / time of day when this happens. Anyway, my first order of business will be just blurring the heck out of this beautiful, crisp, high-res bathymetry data. Because when it comes to raster data, blur equals generalization, and generalization is the name of the game for this trick. I'll open up the raster functions and fire up the statistics raster function. It's a moving window average where you can define how big that window is. I'm going to point it at my image layer, and I'll choose 30 pixels by 30 pixels. That's really blurry. See? That's a pretty good blur. The blur strength that you pick for your watery area of interest is up to you. But I will say, it's easy to underblur. In fact, I like to blur my blur. Sometimes this moving window can have a geometric artifact. So I'll right-click this layer and choose Edit Function Chain, which brings up a little node view interface for my raster functions. And I'm gonna drag that statistics function one more time onto the stage and connect them. The second one, I'll give a strength of half, so 15 and 15. So I've got a 30 pixel by 30 pixel blur and then a 15 by 15 pixel blur. This gives me a safer, smoother, more Gaussian blur. So now I can close this window and dispense with my original high res bathymetry. And now it's time to fire up the beating heart of this trick, which is the contour tool. It's available in 3D Analyst or Spatial Analyst. I'll just do Spatial Analyst, but they're the same thing, either one. I'll point it at my charmingly blurry bathymetry raster and I'll give the resulting vector output a folder and name, and I'll set the contour interval, which is how thick are the stacks, to 100. The unit is driven by the coordinate system of my map. In this case, it's meters. The contour type is a geometric question. I'm gonna choose contour shell up. Contour shell up is like a stack of pancakes. And then I'll run the tool and be shocked at how fast it goes. Next, we'll look at the symbology for this vector polygon layer. And right away, I'll simplify. Instead of unique values, I'll choose single symbol. They all look the same. And now I'll dig into how all of these same looking polygons appear. I'll set the fill color to one of these blues, and the outline color I'll set to white. Later on, this white outline is gonna help these floating polygons look like they have sunlit edges. And I'll give this white outline a semi-transparency, like 50%. And then I'm gonna click on that little wrenchy tool, structure, and I'll add a global effect. Global effects apply to all symbol layers in one fell swoop. And I'll add the move effect. Move lets you nudge the symbol up or down and left or right. Let's do some moving. I'll jump over to that paintbrush tab and I can see the X and Y direction move option. Here. I'll make them both zero because I want to move them dynamically. I want each of these polygons to get pushed up based on its depth value. It's a sneaky way of making this layer sort of 3D. Up here in this Burger Time menu, I'm going to activate the Allow Symbol Property Connections option. And when I do that, every visual variable now has a cute little cylinder button next to it. So now, the data attribute behind each individual polygon can help drive a visual symbology. In this case, a move in the Y dimension. And I'll move it based on its depth value, contour min. But this place is deep, so these numbers are going to be big. Too big. They'll just get blasted right off the screen. So I'll divide the depth value by 30. I found that's a pretty good look. You might need more or less depending on your units and your area. And here are our fake 3D results. It looks like a cute little moonscape, but it's the sea floor. And we are officially done with that wonderful GEBCO source data, so I'll remove that. Next, I'll create a version of this layer that I'll use for lighting effects. To make a copy of a layer in Pro, you can hold the control key and just drag it down. Isn't that cool? I'll rename this to shading so my simple mind can keep keep them straight. And for this new shading layer, I'm going to steal the outline and trick it into becoming a shadow. So I'll drag this line symbol layer underneath the fill, and then I'll make the fill white so that I can make these outlines look like little shadows hovering underneath the disks. I'll do that by making it a gradient stroke. I'll make the width really big, like 20 points. And the gradient I'll make look shadowy, so it'll go from black to transparent black. Now you may notice that some of these polygons don't look quite right. They look inside out. The shadow goes the wrong way. What's up with that? And it has to do with the winding order of the polygon. Some of them are rendering as islands when they should be rendering as holes. If you ever run into this kind of thing, there's a great geoprocessing tool called Repair Geometry. I use this all the time in my projects, even if I don't see an issue. I'll use the OGC or Open Geospatial Consortium if you aren't into that whole brevity thing, and then I'll point it at either one of my layers. They're the same layer, so it doesn't matter which one I pick. I'll hit run on this magical tool, and in less than a second, it's fixed them. All geometries geometrying the way they should. Now that gradient line is giving me a drop shadow-like effect, but the effect imagines a perfectly top-down light source. I want to make it more nudged down like a real shadow. I've already used a global move effect to push all of these polygons up into a 3D-like perspective. I'm going to add another move effect, but this time just to the outline. So for that outline, I'll add an effect of move. So I've got a global move effect making everything look sort of 3D, and then I've got an additional move effect just to the gradient outline. I'll move this shadow to the right a little, and then down kind of a lot. And the result is pretty effective. Now we've got something that really looks like it's illuminated. A pseudo 3D surface with a slightly upper left light source. You know, where humans want to see a light source for some reason. And now it's time to blend these grayscale fake lighting tones of the lighting layer into the underlying original layer. Color burn does that really well. And the next bit is a lot of fun. We get to choose a color gradient to apply to the original underlying bathymetry slices instead of just blue, you know? So I'll click on that magical little green vary symbology by attribute tab, and for color, I'll choose contour min. That's the depth value. And by default, I have a pretty oceanic color scheme. It's backwards though. I'd like the deep colors to be darker. So I'll open the symbology and flip it and hit OK, which I really dig. But there's a lot of color gradients here, and you can surprise yourself with some of the cool things you do. This magma option looks really cool. What else? Oh, maybe you just want to do like a grayscale. That's cool too, pretty dramatic. This blue-green-yellow gradient has a nice nautical quality to it. There's no wrong choice. It's up to you what sort of vibe you're going for. I do like the blue-green-yellow, but actually here's a slightly tamer version of that gradient. It's reversed though, so let me open up its color scheme properties and flip this, and I love it. Makes me think. Next, we can make it a little more oceany, and I'm going to open up the properties for this map and give it a background color of dark blue. And while I'm here, I can play with some projections. So instead of the, you know, not really projected WGS 84, I can choose the world from space. That's one of my favorites, literally. And you can also search for projections. And it's important every now and then to take a quick tour of our handiwork. Stop and smell the roses, see what we've got. I love watching the layers of depth render in individually. It's pretty wonderful. And lastly, and perhaps leastly, I'd like to add a little bit of a water ripple effect. And I'm going to add the vector tile layer we made in a previous video, just to give this a little bit of dappled water lighting. And if one layer of texture isn't enough, maybe two layers is. I hope you visit the GEBCO website, check it out, see what they're about, download that beautiful free data, and just play. Maybe you'll do something much more practical than rendering pseudo 3D bathymetry isometric block diagrams. But you know what? That's kind of practical too.